All right, everybody, and welcome to the epic, awesome show, anime podcast number 208. And I'm Zain, and along with me is...
Hi, I'm Teketria.
Hey, yeah, he's back.
Yeah.
And we are finally back, and we are raring to kind of get into place here. We're doing some weird, different... We're basically trying to do some different stuff here, kind of going over the entire library of Studio Trigger and kind of maybe going over some other studios in the future.
Yeah.
And that might include, you know, that might also include some Gainax, some Bones, because everyone, you know, there's certain shows that Bones have done that. Granted, those go into different studios, but that's a whole nother thing. Hold on, the ball game here. So, I guess we probably should go over the history a little bit of Studio Trigger and kind of how in the like the style, I guess.
Yeah. So, I'm actually glad that you brought up Gainax, because Trigger was actually made by a former employee of Gainax. One who helped direct both Gurren Lagann and Panty and Stocking. That's kind of like the vibe you can feel from a lot of the Studio Trigger shows, that you can definitely see where that, like, where the roots come from for that.
Yeah. Definitely. Especially with some of the character designs. I mean, there's so many Kamina character designs that it is kind of ridiculous at some points.
Very much so. You can also see a lot of like the pop style that some of the action sequences have. Very, very stylish. But also,
I would think it's probably more. It might actually wind up being more prevalent in Gurren Lagann that you would see a lot of the styles that you pretty much Trigger is known for.
Oh yeah.
Versus Panty and Stocking, because I think Panty and Stocking is more of a Western style show, correct?
Oh yeah, they're it's very meant for like a Western audience, but both are very like big in face. Mm-hmm. You can definitely see that.
Yeah,
I think one of the like more common things with Gurren Lagann is that when you see, you know, like these big epic battles, you can, and even like with the transitional screens,
mm-hmm.
you can see this very like stylistic choices that they make a lot of the time, and you can see that in a lot of like the fight scenes and things like Kill la Kill. And there's like a lot of action there that carries the same feeling to it.
Mm-hmm. However, you know, the one thing that Trigger loves to do and for some reason can't get away from it is going to space or having things come down from space.
Oh yeah, that's something that made sense in shows like Gurren Lagann, mm-hmm. where the next big thing is in space, but sometimes doesn't make as much sense in Trigger things.
Oh, you mean like something like Darling in the Franxx?
Yeah, that was a very subterranean, like quite literally.
Mm-hmm.
Like you're going into fight these underground monsters or things that pop out from the ground, and then you find yourself in space somehow. It happens. It's weird, but hey, you know, that's how they roll sometimes.
Yeah, this is true. I mean, Trigger, I will admit one thing about Trigger, and it's something that I really love about them, is when they commit to a joke, they commit 110% or even like 200% to that joke, and they have no shame.
Oh yeah. They go really, really deep on it, but at the same time, it leads to some pretty interesting and strong openings, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I, for the most part, still enjoy a lot of the beginning of most of their shows.
Yeah.
I think Space Patrol Luluco is probably one of the more interesting openings. It's not as strong, but still carries it.
Yeah. I would say probably in opening-wise, and having to go in the just the first episode alone, I might say that their weakest one, for being kind of just meh, not really being that interesting, is Kiznaiver.
It definitely does a lot of nothing in the beginning. That's true.
Yeah. It's
it's interesting how much nothing happens, but at the same time, they are at least trying to set up for stuff in the future. There's an effort being made.
I would say it's the slowest moving.
Definitely.
Out of the bunch that they have there, I mean, Promare easily throughout the gate, literally, you know, within the first 5 minutes, whether you actually really love this movie or you're just, no, I'm done. I'm tapping out.
Unfortunately, true. I don't like figuring out that I don't want to see a movie at the beginning, but, you know, on the bright side, it'll definitely tell me if I'm going to enjoy myself, which is great. I very much enjoy enjoying myself.
Which granted, I think, you know, we were talking about this beforehand, before we're even recording for this episode, and we were talking about, you know, the different things, you know, that Trigger is known for, the fact that they're a lot of substance without any...
Oh yeah, there's
anything happening, I guess, that's what you were saying?
There's sometimes... It's more of a style than substance thing.
That's the exact word there.
So, like, for example, in Kill la Kill, there's a lot of over-the-top things, and it's very stylish.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of style to it, but there's not as much depth to the needless amounts of violence. It's still hilarious, and I love it, but it's more of a stylistic choice to have it.
Yeah.
As you can kind of easily, like, for example, episode 4, when they're, you know, going to school, there's a lot of needless violence on the way to school. But you can kind of, in a sense, montage yourself through that. They choose not to, for style. But not necessarily for a deeper meaning, which is because I love that sequence. Great.
But even through that entire episode of them just trying to give them sex, Senketsu, it's just as beautiful, the fact that of how many times they just all burst into blood and...
Oh, yeah.
The comedy that goes into every single frame of just that episode alone is beautiful. And it's really Trigger at their best. I mean, even going into the newest episode, like with BNA Brand New Animal, I honestly thought they did a great job of hooking you within the first episode. And really showing you exactly what this, what is actually can and can't happen. The one thing I will say about most Trigger shows, and they do a really good job on, the only one I think they do a terrible job on it, is Darling in the Franxx, is setting up their world.
I think they set up the world quite well. It's just a not so interesting world.
Well, no, I mean, Darling in the Franxx, for instance, like, not really setting up the world was fine. It's like, what can and can't happen.
I mean, I think,
like, for instance, with Kill la Kill, and the fact that her Kamui basically can transform.
Yeah.
It's kind of that gradual change to where it's like, it's not like, oh, Darling in the Franxx, oh, we've just, we can transform now into this other thing that we normally couldn't transform into.
I think Darling in the Franxx suffers from the same problem many Trigger shows have, actually, where they have the director, they have the guy who can be stylish, do the thing, but they don't necessarily have the person who writes the shows, right? So they have the director, they have the guy who can, you know, envision things.
Yeah.
He's not necessarily the writer. He's not going to make it a good writer.
True.
He's going to make it so that, you know, it fits that Studio Trigger feel. And it does. Like,
yeah.
And even when he's not at the helm of things, like, there's a lot of times when he's not, they still have that feel.
Yeah. I mean, the one thing I will say about Trigger is that they rarely, for most of their stuff, I don't think they very rarely rely on CG to do what they, you know, to, for battles, for, like, a lot of studios tend to do. I don't think they use anything for even though like the background characters whatsoever. The only one they really use a lot of CG in is Promare. That's mostly due to the fact that the style of the show.
They do it for a lot of the panning shots, yeah.
Yeah. Well, but for panning, it makes sense. I mean, they use it for what I mean by that is that they use CG where it kind of makes sense.
Yeah.
But not for crowds.
I think they have some pretty creative uses for their animation in general. Mm-hmm. You can look at things like Kill la Kill, where you have a character who kind of... there's a character, Nui, who, for the most part, is almost interacting with the animation. Like, mm-hmm. there are characters who follow the laws of animation in their universe. So a character like Mako follows the laws. She just kind of pushes it to its limits. And then you have a character like Nui who is aware of the laws of animation, is constantly breaking them.
Yeah.
Interacting with things. So a good example is, you know, she one time when she's dodging, she like straight up is spinning like a
flat object. Yeah, I know what you're talking about there. Where she's basically kind of this like, whee!
And it looks like a 2D object imposed in a 3D space that then is they're flipping, which is both amazingly cool, but also like a lack of 3D. Mm-hmm. I'm appreciate the lack of 3D because a lot of the time it's not necessarily needed. It's kind of just pushed into things.
Mm-hmm.
So having it like being more restrained about it, for as explosive as a lot of the shows can be, I do actually appreciate a lot because. Like, Kill la Kill would be cool if they had those big 3D panning shots, but also, I like that they don't do that because it allows them to have a character like Nui exist in the first place.
Yeah.
I like that.
Well, Kill la Kill does a lot of that stuff too, but I mean, granted, even when you go into the most un-trigger-esque feel of any show that Trigger's done is super and supernatural battles become commonplace. It just feels like out of their entire catalog for shows that they've ever done, it's the most un-Trigger-esque feel until you look at the comedy and then it's like, oh, that's obviously Trigger.
Yeah. I mean, part of that is because it's not like a Trigger original. It is
it's not a
light novel. So that actually makes sense that it wouldn't necessarily feel that way.
But also even like SS Gridman is another one that kind of has that Trigger-esque feel.
Oh yeah.
Well, it's not
I have a story about that one. So for those of you who don't know, SS Gridman is actually based off a really old show of a similar title. Like the roughly the translated name is Hyper Agent Gridman or Gridman the Hyper Agent.
Yeah,
it's a tokusatsu, which is a live action, like kind of like Ultraman or something like of that.
Yeah,
where you have like this big animated person that does the fighting. Well, not animated, but other things, and you can definitely see it. It has a very similar plot, but. Like, if you watch it physically, it, like, actually burns your eyes to watch, which... It physically hurt me to watch it. It physically hurt, because the frame rate for it is, like, actually awful, but it's still, like, a decent show. It just...
Yeah.
Also... Like, my eyes physically hurt while watching it, which was...
Yeah, I can't say, like, it physically hurt me to watch it, but it's got a very weird... Gridman definitely uses a lot of... It's a very weird mixture of CG and 2D, especially when they're going in for the, you know, some of the battles, especially when you see blood and everything, which I thought was really cool. Like, I thought they did a really good job on that show, where it was just like... And also the character designs on that are really, really nice. Oh, yeah.
I love the upgraded Gridman. I love that they take that tokusatsu feel and can like translate it into an anime. So like it gets a thumbs up from me. I love it. Don't watch the original is what I'll tell you. So, like watch SSS Gridman. You get a similar experience, and if you like tokusatsu, It kind of does have that mixed feeling of an anime tokusatsu.
Yeah. So, kind of going into it a little bit here. So, basically, what we're going to be starting off here is this week we're going to talk about Inferno Cop, and the next time we get together, we're going to be talking about, you know, Turning Girls. And basically, though, actually, the one after that will be the Lubitsch Academia movie. Which is something that, you know, I'm really excited to almost talk about, because this was really where I kind of fell in love with Studio Trigger and their designs. And the fact that the... have you watched the movie at all for Little Witch Academia?
Yeah, yeah. I really enjoyed the movie. The movie was...
Yeah. Okay, so right at the end, where you have the dragon... Yeah. And when he swallows the magic, and the face of the dragon, the fact that, like, where he goes from being, like, super satisfied to being like, uh-oh, I have made a huge, grave mistake, is beautiful. And it's just, like, it's a frame. It's, like, one or two frames, and it's something you could totally miss. And I remember, you know, even with friends being like, okay, you need to watch this. You need to watch this one part of the show, of this movie. Like, if you don't watch any part of this movie, this is the one part. And Trigger basically giving that much facial expressions to, I would say that much facial expressions to that dragon was something that was just like, it's like, oh my goodness, that was amazing. Granted, I don't think we got that in 2013. I think we got that like right before, somewhere I think in 2015, I believe.
Yeah, I can give like a little bit more of an explanation to that. So with Little Witch Academia, they're still in their kind of having no money phase.
Yeah.
So while they're kind of trying to fit the small things they can in there when they, which is also why, if you watch the movie, you also know that it's like really short, because it's also like, I think half an hour or something.
Yeah, it's only like 30 minutes.
It's short because it's all, but they still do try to fit in all of their, like, all the little things they can, which is one why I appreciate the movie a lot, because it, you can see a lot of the heart in it.
Yeah.
But it also does show a little bit of, like, their budget constraints. Because it's still in that, you know, like, we're still trying to get off the ground phase.
Yeah. But I think it was after that, like, because really my introduction to Studio Trigger was Kill la Kill and Little Witch Academia, and I had not watched Inferno Cop or Turning Girl before Ninja Slayer from Animation came in. So going from Kill la Kill, Little Witch Academia, especially the character designs of Ninja Slayer from Animation, like, absolutely amazing character designs.
Yeah.
And I was, like, super hyped for it. I was like, yeah, this is going to be great. This is going to be amazing. And then I watched it, and I'm like, I hate every minute of this.
So, that actually builds into some of the opposite appeal of how, like, some of the previous works that they've worked on existed.
Yeah.
So, like, Ninja Slayer is a, for the most part, like, very Japanese-y type of show. Like, it's, in a sense, because it's also... It has like a very stylistic choice to it in like a, in a sense, Japanese audience, into like the Japanese audience, where because it's actually based off a novel series that is American, but when they adapted it, they kind of took it into a very ninja, like a very Japanese style.
Yeah.
So,
well, I think the biggest reason why I didn't like it was because of how it went from. What I knew Trigger for with this crisp, very dirty clean lines, and then what I got was, oh, what you get with in Inferno Cop and Turning Girls, which I think if it was less minutes, I think if it was the same length as like Turning Girls or Inferno Cop, I think it would have been a lot better. I think I probably would have been like, okay, this is pretty fun.
Yeah, I actually agree with that. So one of the things about Inferno Cop, which we'll talk about later, is that most of the episodes are 2 to 4 minutes long. It's really short, and I recommend that if you've never heard of it, just to like Google it for a second, because it's like this really interesting piece of work where they have pretty much no animation, and Ninja Slayer kind of copies that, but they also have like these very animated segments as well. Mm-hmm. And the part of the problem with that is they clash with each other. You don't have the full feel of little to no animation or hyper animated. You have a little bit of both. And sometimes this can work, but in this case, it kind of clashes with each other more so than it probably would be grateful for.
Yeah, which I don't think they've really done that since. Granted, you have in Kill la Kill, you have bits and pieces of it that they do it with.
A better example of it is actually in Space Patrol Luluco.
Mm-hmm.
They have a character, they have just one character that has stilted animation as a joke. And that's fine. That actually works really well because it's just one character. It's not like the whole show.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you have to be like more specific about because Ninja Slayer kind of feels like it's just jumping in between them at times, mm-hmm. you don't get that same feel.
Yeah.
And so that hurts it a lot.
Yeah. I mean, the same thing, like, the reason why Kill la Kill, I bring up Kill la Kill with that, is that they, at times, they use that same type of animation, even with, what's her face, the scissor chick. When she is dodging, it's basically that same style of for comedy. They use it a lot more, I would say they use it definitely a lot more for comedy, especially Nudist Colony is hilarious. Yeah.
For Nui, she uses it to great effect. A lot of her things are done on purpose in a way that, like, it doesn't feel like they're just swapping in between. A lot of it actually feels on purpose.
Yeah.
Now, whether you like those or not is going to be different, but they are very on purpose, and you can kind of see it when it happens because it happens specifically like with her. Another times are, you know, in other shows they do it on purpose. So they've learned from Ninja Slayer at least that it's not something you can kind of just throw out.
Mm-hmm.
Something you have to like,
which is
figure out. And then
it's kind of interesting that it's the same director literally for Inferno Cop, Ninja Slayer from animation, and SSS Gridman.
Yeah.
So it's just like, I was just kind of surprised by it. Like, the only thing I've not like this guy has done is Ninja Slayer from animation, mostly due to the fact that it's just what I guarantee you it's because of, like, I gave it a 2. Like, that's how much I did not like it. And I think it's literally that reaction I got from it was because of I was expecting something completely different and not really knowing the history behind.
Yeah. That can definitely hurt it.
So I think that's also the other thing, too, because I think what they were trying to do with Ninja Slayer from animation was kind of merge the past and present together. Not successfully.
I think it's more of like they were experimenting. Like, they mm-hmm. they tried to figure out when those still shots work and when they don't. I think that I personally like it, by the way, but I understand it's not everyone's cup of tea, and for the most part most people probably won't actually like it that much, but at the same time, to me at least, it has a certain charm to it because I kind of jumped into it after watching Inferno Cop.
That makes sense that you would have a completely different feel for it,
and after like just after watching Inferno Cop, one of like the many times I have,
mm-hmm.
It has like the charm still to it, but as you know, episodes kind of are longer. It does feel like it drags on a little bit.
Yeah, so. I mean, it's kind of like the same thing for me with Ninja Slayer. Kind of has the same issue that I believe Pop Team Epic has, to where they take one joke, and it's just the entirety of every episode.
Well, so Pop Team Epic is more spontaneous, whereas in Ninja Slayer it keeps going and going and going. It kind of needs to stop after 5 minutes. Pop Team Epic is, like, at least to me, very fine, because it doesn't linger on the same thing for too long. It kind of is, in a sense, too ADD to stick to one thing at a time. Which is fine, because that means it's going to stay high energy.
Yeah, but it's like
Ninja Slayer, which it has its downs, and when it has its downs, it's like, I'm going to look at my phone, I'm going to do something else.
But like, I can think of a show that did like the high energy 80 super well. You know, better than what Pop Team Epic did, and that was Freakazoid.
I mean, I would say that current Pop Team Epic is it's hard to tell, because you have this weird situation where you have something as old as Freakazoid versus something as new as Pop Team Epic.
That's true. But it also might come into the point where a lot of people, which granted, I know a lot of people love Pop Team Epic, and it's like, and there's this, you know, and basically, you know, the meme at this point, like pretty much anybody who's listened to this podcast probably knows the fact that my tastes are usually against the grain, and usually, you know, what's actually good versus my actual taste is
very, very shonen centric.
Yeah, it's very much a small little gap.
It's very shonen centric. on the bright side, it has been making me and a few friends finding anime for you a lot easier. So, like, there's technically a bright side to it.
Yes, there is always a very big bright side there. Okay, so kind of going back here into, let's talk a little bit about Inferno Cop.
Yeah.
And the first series that ever, well, technically not series, but the first original animation that Trigger ever did.
Yeah. So here's where we get to come back to the whole starting phase of Trigger. So, mm-hmm. you know, they're Trigger. They need to make money because, you know, you need money as a studio.
Yep.
But you don't really have money to start with. So Inferno Cop effectively has, like, no money to start with and is you know, them trying to make money. And it's both a hilarious and wild ride because of that. If you don't know it, it will look like it's garbage because it's in it, because if you don't know, it is a movie, it's like no budget.
Mm-hmm.
So there's maybe like three voice actors total that share too many lines together. And there's actually no animation. Like all of its stilted movements.
Mm-hmm.
Inferno Cop never moves. They just move him across the backdrop. And a lot of these,
I think the most animation is like the flames, I think.
Almost definitely.
And that's all stock, I think.
And it's like a stock flame animation. And the backgrounds are all like, I'm pretty sure, public domain. Like these are public domain that they find and
which I think there's a few of them that they did that were, I think they probably they probably created some of the backdrops themselves.
They've like recolored a few, but a lot of it's a lot of it is public domain. Once again, very funny.
Yeah. I would say like one of my comments in episode one, literally starting off, was low budget to the max.
Oh yeah. So it starts off in this great way where, you know, these thugs are mugging a defenseless pregnant woman because, you know, they're thugs.
Mm-hmm.
And a cop comes by, and there is a talk between them, but no lips are moving, and the way it's resolved is both hilarious and stupid.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, them saying, like, we pay taxes. Oh, you do? I am so sorry. I thought you were doing something bad. Okay. Here we go. Whee! Even better is the fact that he's talking about, it's like, I'm going to download some legal anime. Oh, yeah,
he says that as he goes back.
And explodes.
And, like, it's the craziness of Inferno Cop is a sight to behold. It is. Because no matter how much I explain an episode, You really have to kind of watch them to kind of understand how crazy they can be.
Yeah.
A good example of this is, like, you know, in the first episode, you know, you're going through the entirety of this thing, and then at the end of it, the lady's water breaks, and it's this just giant geyser. And, like, you know, me explaining this makes no sense until you, like, get to the second episode, where all that water now is filling up the area.
Yeah.
And it's like, what? They kept it in, and then it keeps going from there.
Oh, yeah, no. Then of course, you know, I think a note I think I had from it, let's see here. So I was taking notes until, like, the, I think, episode 6, and I just gave up. I think episode 2, the recap was amazing, because it was basically the entire episode, or at least a part of, a really good chunk of the episode of the recap. Oh, and then the other cap is the baby, and of course the baby being born into a rival king, apparently the scar. Yes. The scar is apparently, you're born with that scar, so you're, you know, screwed from birth to be in the gang. And finding out that it's a monster, and then bullets can bounce off on him, and then apparently can bounce off. It's like, aha, your words are, I'm rubber, you're glue. It bounced off me and blows you up.
Yep. The baby turns out to be a giant crap monster thing. And Inferno Cop's like, wait, I have a gun. And so he shoots his gun underwater.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, it still functions, apparently.
Yeah.
And, oh my god, that it's so great, because, you know, the baby monster is like, I'm immune to your bullets. And Inferno Cop's like, well, I'm immune to my bullets as well. But it doesn't stop the baby from being immune to bullets. But you know, it's not one of those things you want to think about, because it's not about making sense. It's about, you know, going along with the ride. And it's a perfect example of it.
Oh, it's definitely. I will definitely say Inferno Cop is definitely one of those shows where if you watch it, just don't try to figure out what's going on, because your brain will just be like, just turn off your brain and just enjoy it. Just go along for the ride. Especially going into episode 3, where Inferno Cop is being charged with, I think, murder and infanticide, I think?
Yeah, he's charged for infanticide because, you know, he did kill a baby.
Yeah,
technically. A giant monster baby, but still a baby. And, and then for mutilating corpses.
Oh, yeah, mutilating.
He shot all those bad guys.
I mean, they technically weren't corpses until he shot them and blew them up, but...
It's kind of dumb, but funny still.
Oh, yeah. No, it is quite ridiculously over the top, especially going into episode 3, where basically it's an entire episode's an Ace Attorney reference.
It's a lot of things.
And the fact that it's like, oh, here's the thing that says you're guilty. Granted, the Termin arc, which basically it is, goes all the way to Supreme Court, and... I guess what makes it really great is, like, goes from being like, he's guilty, okay, death penalty. No death penalty.
Yep.
Innocent.
You know, I didn't do anything, not guilty. I have proof, guilty, death penalty. And it's a good, it's an amazing back and forth, because it at the beginning of the episode, and at the end of, so at the end of the original second episode, you're introduced to Mr. Judge, and Mr. Judge then is the final attorney that has to deal with this case, and it's a really funny back and forth, because you're introduced to this what the heck character, who persists a lot longer than you'd think, and it's great.
I mean, one thing I will say about this one, that there are times where certain jokes get drawn out, and it's like, yeah, this is very Trigger-esque, that sometimes they like to, for the comedy effect of it, And here on a joke that just, like, for some reason is just, okay, it kind of, you think it outlasts its hilariousness, where it's like, okay, this is just kind of getting annoying here. You're just staying on this a little too long, but then it's throw something out there where it's just like, okay, it brought it back and made it quite funny again. Like the whole thing of an episode 4 where I wrote down FBI are Pokemon.
Okay, well, it's not that much, but
well, that's all the thing to say is FBI.
Yeah, so the Southern Cross who have captured Inferno Cop. So, like, jumping forward a bit, he gets in a car crash, and so what they have to do is they get him in the hospital. The Southern Cross sends in their top assassin, the FBI, who say nothing but FBI, or a variant of it in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of becomes a really weird, like, wow, this is like super extra, but it's also great because at the same time it like it shows how like how nonsensical it is.
Mm-hmm.
Which is you know, great.
Oh yeah, definitely. Especially because like after he escapes and is being apparently worked on and I think technically killed, like he's more being, I think his surge is more likely stabbing him instead of actually doing anything?
Probably. Like, so, because it's, once again, low budget, when he says, like, scalpel, and then he just stabs Inferno Cop with his scalpel. And they even do this thing where he's like, don't you die on me. And then he just stabs him again.
Yeah. That's great. But what makes this even better, because it goes into episode 5, with a zombie, apparently it's been 80 years, somehow, and zombie apocalypse.
Yep, a zombie apocalypse has happened.
Yeah, which makes it really even funnier when going into episode 5, is where they're, like, you have the zombie apocalypse that's going on, and it's just like an everyday event. It's just an everyday, like, occurrence, like, you know, oh, we got a horde of zombies coming through here. It's going to be a wild weekend. I would say stay inside.
Yep, they treat it like any other weather that's happening, mm-hmm. which is both played up to great comedic effect. And you also get to hear some of that great voice acting amongst, like, once again, three different voice actors.
But also episode 5 also gives us the Mecha Cop, I think?
Yeah, so they have now introduced Inferno Cop's rival, if you will, Mecha Cop, who is this... He is this person who... Not person, but robot, who was made specifically to defeat Inferno Cop, assumedly designed by the Southern Cross. But, I mean, heck if we know. That's never said, and why would it?
No, I mean, what makes it even better is the fact that he basically transforms, he's supposed to kill him, transforms into a car for some reason. Oh, because they Southern Cross gave him a
robot body.
Yeah, a robot body that can transform into a car. And the car takes them, and they go back into time with the dinosaurs.
Yeah.
That's literally because, breaking reality.
Yeah, it's because he pushes him so fast through time and space that's mm-hmm. what happens.
Yeah.
And, well, they say it's, like, I believe they named the era, but not it's like actually true, because it's, like, also some tribal, like, pre-human, mm-hmm. well, not pre-human, but like pre-Neanderthal beings.
Yeah. I mean, it's also kind of the thing where he's going like, oh, in the U.S., they, like, saying all of these things, it sounds super convincing, and it is absolutely fantastic, and I love it. It's, but then they, you know, wind up going, getting worshipped, you know, as you do, you know, you're about to be eaten, and finding out that, oh, they must be gods. And then getting God angry and getting sent to hell.
Yep. So, you know, going along with this three episodes so far, they first have a zombie apocalypse that's in 80 years in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have the going back in time, and then they are sent to hell, but it's like current day hell actually, which is even more extra considering, you know, like they went back in time.
Yeah, but then they find a nice old lady that's in hell.
Yeah, so they find Inferno Cop's aunt in hell.
And he had to find his, and she lost her husband in hell.
Yeah. And this moves Mecha Cop enough that finding someone and helping out has changed his outlook to the point that he wants to become, you know, like a real cop in hell. And so he does.
But then you have, and then apparently we just found out, according to Inferno Cop, there's just there's an exit to hell. It's just a, you know,
oh yeah,
stop.
It's like a subway exit.
Mm-hmm.
It's great.
And then he winds up in actual normal time, not in 80 years in the future time.
Yeah. It's really funny, actually. Because, like, he's still in car form during this time. So, like, throughout hell, he's been in car form. And throughout, like, through the dinosaurs, has also been in car form. So he's just been in this car form the entire time. And then when he comes back, he's still in his car form, and he's zipping by, leaving a trail of fire. And you see this kid get bullied. And when Inferno Cop passes by, he lights this kid on fire. And the kid is like, this burns my skin.
Yeah, and I would say basically kills him for the first time.
Yeah, and then he gets reborn as a Hellfire Boy.
Yeah.
Hellfire Boy, of course, being this really weird...
A boy with a candle up for a head?
Yeah, it's like this really weird, like, look at this kid superhero kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so he partners up with Inferno Cop because, you know, he's given him superpowers. And so they decide to enter a race because, you know, there's a million yen as the reward.
Mm-hmm. And so they can take over the world.
Yeah, this out of the nowhere, so we can take over the world line, quote, which is both great and stupid.
Yes, and then and in that race, basically it's either reminiscent of Wacky Races or the anime Wacky Races.
It's kind of like a reference to a bunch of the racing stuff in general.
Genres.
Like genres, but also like shows.
Yeah.
And like Inferno Cop specifically has this really weird but funny like he and Mr. Judge, who has reappeared now, somehow, some way, is now like in the lead, who's also in the lead. They're like neck and neck, they're trying to do stuff. And Hellfire Boy's like, quick, use me as fuel, that way we can get the boost we need. And you hear him like cry in pain as he is going through this, by the way. It's not like,
yeah.
It's not like, oh yeah, you know, like, nice and simple. No, he's like screaming in pain. and as that happens, it's like, you know, Inferno Cop is neck and neck with, you know, like Mr. Judge. They're doing all this stuff. And then he loses the race anyways.
Hey, what, like, makes, oh, even, okay. What actually makes it even better is the fact that he still wins a million yen.
Yeah, like this judge is holding his check, and they're like, and for second place, also a million yen. Like, oh, and he's happy about it. It's amazing.
And then you go into the next episode with, you know, he's depressed. He needs to take the his apparently, I don't know what is left of him at this point. But he finds a 99 yen cruise.
Yeah, $1 for a world cruise. Mm-hmm. And he's like, damn, that's cheap. I'm going to do that right now. And he does.
Yeah, and the cruise, man, it cruises.
Yeah, it went, they did find a boat image. And a background image. They took as little time as they needed, and they just made it go forward.
Then he winds up in, you know, then he winds up in Egypt.
As for Hellfire Boy's final wishes, the flashback that we never see actually any of that events happen. Where he's just like, if I die, spread my ashes in Egypt. No clue why Egypt. Mm-hmm. But, you know, hey, what do we know? And man, it's great.
No, it is. And then basically, he winds up going into the pyramid. Actually, no, I think he gets the bread before where he.
Yeah, he does.
Where he like it reminds me so much of a Hellfire Boy.
Yeah, he finds some darkened bread, and Hellfire Boy, originally is like white skinned, and then when he is Hellfire Boy, he has, you know, darker charred skin.
Yeah.
So when Inferno Cop finds this darker bread, he puts on like a little mask, and he's crying over Hellfire Boy, but he still eats the bread.
But it's like, delicious.
It's like it's great because it's like he eats this bread that, you know, otherwise is a reminder of Hellfire Boy.
Mm-hmm. And
and now that his stomach is full, he now needs to go. And
to the pyramids.
Yeah, to I don't even know why he enters it. He's supposed to be scattering some ashes.
I honestly don't have. It's like he's just going to getting past all the traps and then takes on the ultimate pharaoh to apparently assert his it's like Pokemon really, where you're the new champion now. Okay, I just wait here now for the next challenger.
And he forgot to turn off his cell phone though, which turns to bite him in the butt as the police chief is like, "Yo, where have you been? Like, what are you doing?" He's like, "All right, shit, I need to go get, I need to do my job as a police officer," which is both like hilarious and dumb.
Yeah, which granted, I'm actually very surprised. I want to know who his carrier is because. That good of reception in the pyramids? Man, I want that reception.
Yeah. It is pretty good. you know, like and this is where like the current story takes more of a like if you've followed Gainax, you followed Trigger, you might actually be able to recognize part of the ending. Because once he makes it back into Jackknife, you know, great name for his town, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
He is captured by these alien invaders. And they make a reference to Eva. It's a reference to Third Impact, but they call it
Throw Up.
Well,
something here. No,
it does this. It does this very magical thing where, like, he's surprised. And they even do a bit where, you know, all the people are saying like, "Hey, I'm you," and when he turns around, it's like, "Ah, it can't be Inferno Cop." but it creates this like really funny.
Yeah,
really funny thing.
And which granted, this is when he's actually spewing up.
But oh, no, this is not yet.
Okay, not yet. Okay, I've been getting ahead of myself here.
Yeah, so eventually, then he meets the pregnant woman all the way from season from the first not first season first episode where she reveals herself to be a woman named Claudia.
Oh yeah, Claudia, not the Scarlet Witch.
So it's a very similar outfit. and it was all her plan all along for all of these events to happen so that she could marry Inferno Cop.
Everybody Inferno Cop.
And this is the part where he starts throwing up.
Okay. And that's when we run into Hellfire Boy again.
Who is fused with the bread version of himself.
Mm-hmm.
Very important to note that this is a sentient talking piece of bread.
Yes. So this would be the... So then he winds up getting over-emotional and eating the bread again and killing him for a third time.
It was apparently good enough to eat while there was, like, barf on it, but...
Yeah. It was definitely one of those times where during that, just that scene alone was definitely one of the times where it was like, okay, I think they went on a little too long and recovered it with the stupidity of, oh, it's him. To where if it was something like Family Guy, they probably would have just been like, oh, stay on it way too long and there's no payout.
Yeah. Probably.
And they released that payout, which was, you know, I do actually quite enjoy that.
The good news about Inferno Cop is, like, even though we're describing this, the only actual long episode is the one we're describing right now, which is the 13th episode.
And where he goes Super Saiyan, I guess? Glitter?
He enters his golden form.
Oh, yeah.
Whatever you want to call it. They call it
Glitter Cop.
Inferno Cop.
Yeah.
Which, you know, as golden forms go, it's pretty golden.
Mm-hmm.
And he uses his power as a god because he became a god still.
Yeah. To change everybody back.
Yep. And everyone then gives his power to lend Inferno Cop fighting Claudia. And so this is the part that's kind of funny. They actually do call back a few of the characters. Like, you can see Mr. Judge clearly. You can see a reporter that had been in the show.
Multiple times.
Yeah. And when Claudia uses her attack, which is throwing her body at Inferno Cop like a boomerang, the head's still, like, detached. But Mecha Cop shows up to destroy... destroy the projectile body. Claudia is still fine as a head, I guess.
Yeah, I mean,
but like, it's also
you had to survive.
Yeah, it's also like, you know, the all of it comes full circle for some reason. And Inferno Cop, he does some great things.
Yeah,
there, but he in the end. Defeats Claudia in this big explosion where people think he has sacrificed himself. And then it's revealed to you that this is actually like a story that Hellfire Boy's original persona is telling his girlfriend in like the far future. And then they pan to a shot with Inferno Cop somewhere further along,
yeah,
being alive all along. So there's a lot of loose ends there still, which is both like they exist. Like, what happens about Southern Cross? Who cares?
Yeah.
What about everything else?
Yeah, it doesn't really.
How did Mecha Cop come from hell? Yeah. Why does it matter?
Yeah, but what makes this even better? Like, the reason why this is even 12 minutes long is the credits.
Oh yeah, so I guess I was going to try to hide this, but it's been spoiled. So
yeah.
The episode is supposedly 12 minutes long, but in actuality, it is another 4-minute segment. But the credits both go by super slow and fast, at different irregular speeds, because it just makes it the show, you know, go.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense.
but it's pretty great.
It definitely is really amazingly great.
It is a full credit sequence. It is everything from every episode.
I mean, from this series alone, like for Inferno Cop, I would say it was definitely very much a strong start for Studio Trigger. Even watching this through the second time, I absolutely had a blast of fun, just because it was nonsensical, stupid. It was very short, and you don't feel like you're wasting a bunch of time watching this because you're just having fun.
Oh yeah.
Having a great time.
It never overstays its welcome, which is very appreciated.
Yeah.
A lot of shows that are in comedy, you know, they might have a skit or whatever, but a lot of the time, depending on the length of the show, to pad out time, you know, they stay longer than they need to. This creates a lot of problems, whereas Inferno Cop, being 2 to 4 minute episodes, kind of like short segments from a bigger show. And it does have a story. It kind of makes sense if you think about it, but don't, because that would be dumb. Instead, kind of just like enjoy the ride.
Yeah.
It gives you enough time to not really have to question anything, which is just perfect.
Yeah. It's definitely one of those shows where it's great because it's just a fun, low budget show that obviously they had absolutely no budget for it.
Oh yeah.
And it's amazing. So with that being said, unfortunately we've run out of time this week. So thank you guys so much for watching, and hopefully you guys enjoyed this first look into Studio Trigger. And we're gonna actually look into doing more stuff through Studio Trigger. Next time is gonna be Turning Girls. And after that, it'll actually probably be Little Witch Academia movie then Kill la Kill. So it's going to be a great time. And also we're going to be looking at some of the anime that has come out into the winter anime, which it's going to be an amazing season.
It's going to be a pretty good season.
That right now, it's probably winter 2021 is probably the most jam-packed season, and the most... not jam-packed, but it's very jam-packed, but it's the most...
It'll have new stuff, it'll have sequels, it'll have everything.
Yeah, it'll have... I mean, going into next year, it's going to be an insane, wild year. If you think this year was wild, you're in for an even better treat for... while being good, not, you know, anything else that's possibly have happened, you know. but yeah, no, it's going to be a great time. Thank you guys so much for watching. And this has been Zain and
Teketria.
And we'll see you guys on the flip side.